my name's Olivia, and I have bilateral cochlear implants, which means I have implants on both sides of my head. And I lost my hearing when I was about 3.5 years old, and my parents made the decision to implant me because I was already talking. And so basically, it's been my journey ever since up to here, and I've lived pretty much my whole life with cochlear implants, and I chose design just for me, for kind of like the fun thing to do, and that's kind of the basic. So, nice. Questions?
Okay.
Get a little bit more into to depth with the questions.
Yes. What kind of hearing loss do you have?
Okay. So basically, my hearing loss, I believe, is middle ear. It's you have the internal tubes in your ear with the cilia that vibrate when sound comes in. So basically, my little tubes don't vibrate because all the cilia are either gone or it's lying flat. So basically, I don't have them to vibrate.
And how did you lose your hearing?
So it happened overnight. And it's kind of a weird way of explaining it. Okay, so the doctor said they wouldn't be able to predict it, but after I lost my hearing, they could see that I was gonna lose it. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? Okay, because it's like really confusing. So basically, I told my parents that I felt sick to my stomach, and then they were like, okay, because I was at my grandma's house. And then my dad came and picked me up, and I jumped out of the car, like when he opened the car door, because I was like 3 years old, and I'm like, yay! And so I jumped out, and I got my foot caught on the seat belt, and I hit my head. But like, you know, three-year-olds hit their heads all the time. And so like, they didn't think anything of it, and my dad brought me inside, and he's like, Well, they were talking to me, and I'm like, oh, why are you making your voices sound weird? Because their voices were really bubbly, and I couldn't, like, really understand them. And so I went to bed the next morning. I couldn't hear at all. So that's how I lost it. And basically, the medical term is enlarged vestibular aqueducts, which is what I have. So.
Okay. And why did your parents decide on cochlear implants?
Okay, so I'm an only child, and they would focus like on me a lot. They basically made my speech and my reading above what it should be for my age. And so I was like really, really super advanced for a three-year-old. And when I lost my hearing, obviously I could talk. And nobody else in my family was deaf. Nobody else had this happen to them. So they were like, okay, like, do we send her to a deaf school? Do we get hearing aids or what? And they found cochlear, and it was pretty, I mean, it wasn't new, but it was not well known at the time. And they were talking to people in cochlear, and they decided to go that way because I was an applicant for it. Not all people can have cochlear implants. It depends on their hearing loss. And so they went ahead and did it. And so through the time in between my loss and the surgery, I went to like several places, and they were gonna do a study on me, but they said I was too advanced for my age, even with my hearing loss, that they can't do speech therapy on me because I didn't need it. They can't do any studies on me because I'm like, I don't have anything wrong with me except I can't hear. So that's why I decided to implant me, because, well, I could talk and well above what I should be talking, so.
Okay. Did you get both implants at the same time?
No. So the surgery and the implants are extremely expensive. And they're like not an out-of-pocket pay. The insurance would not pay for both of them, and they're like, you don't need two ears to hear. So from the time I got implanted, I was 4 years old, and I basically lived with one ear up until I was in fourth grade, which I think is 9, 10, okay. So I lived several years with one ear, and I learned to lip read, and I could lip read very well. You could have a normal conversation with me, and I could understand everything. Finally, like, my parents fought, because I needed two ears to hear. I couldn't hear directional sounds, so if you called me and you were somewhere, I wouldn't be able to hear where you were calling me, because I had no direction, I had like no depth in the hearing. So they finally got the second surgery cleared when I was the summer before I was in fourth grade. So then after that, I could hear normally.
did you ever go to speech therapy?
No, I didn't need it. What we did go to was an auditory verbal therapist, which is just basically making sure my mapping for my implants were okay and everything was lining up and I wasn't going backwards, I was going forwards. So, no, I did not have speech therapy.
Okay, can you explain mapping?
Okay, yes. When you first get the implant, you go in like frequently to make sure everything's lining up, and especially for younger kids because the skull will grow over the magnet, so you need to like adjust like the frequencies and like all these things that I don't know what they are. But now I go in once a year, and it's just to make sure like tweaking everything. It's kind of like when you get your car checked, like, okay, is everything working all right, do we need to change anything, everything's good. I'm actually due for a mapping in August, I think. So like my parents and my boyfriend can tell, like, I think it's time for you to have a mapping, because like I'll start to like not being able to understand as much, and I have to say what a lot. So like when I get my mapping, it's like a tune-up kind of. Mm-hmm. So yeah,
that helps. Okay, what can you hear and what can't you hear?
I can hear everything you all can hear, and there is nothing that I really can't hear. In crowded situations, it's a little bit harder because there's noise everywhere, but it's gotten a lot better. When I only had one earpiece, it was like everywhere at once because I couldn't direct sound, but now I'm just like, okay, whatever. I can pretty much hear what everyone else can hear. I was in band, wind ensemble actually, and so like, I was fine in band and everything, so there's literally nothing that I can't hear. And I always think it's great because like as people get older, you start to lose your hearing. I won't.
That's very true. Okay, do you consider yourself to be deaf?
I consider myself to be both deaf and hearing because I can just take them off and I can hear perfectly fine. I can't hear perfectly fine. Wow. I can take them off and I can't hear, or I put them on and I can hear perfectly fine. And so, I don't have them on all the time. When I sleep, I can't do it when I sleep. It's so uncomfortable. I take them off when I shower, when I go swimming, and like sometimes, like on the weekend, if I'm not doing anything, I'm like, you know what? I just want some peace and quiet. So I just take them off and I just, you know, zone out. So like, I feel like I'm both. I'm not really specific to one, because I will always have them, but then I can always choose not to have them.
Have you ever used a sign language interpreter?
No, I've never used any interpreter ever in my whole cochlear implant existence. I've never really needed one, so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. What made you take sign language?
For fun, mostly. I went to Redlands High School and I saw they were offering the class, and my parents supported my decision because what if something like sometimes like the frequencies in the air with the radio frequencies could mess them up, and if there's ever something like in the future that for some reason interferes with them and like messes up, because they're basically like a little computer, and so if I were to lose that or they have to take out the magnet for whatever reason, I have another resource to use to communicate with people. Like what, you know, what if something happened, basically.
Okay, so in class we've just watched Sand and Fury, which is about the cochlear implant debate. How do you feel after watching it?
I've seen this movie a few times, but I feel like it's up to the people, and for my family it was a better fit for me to get cochlear implants, but like it might not be for somebody else's. It's kind of like own personal preference, and I think it's a great technology because, you know, I can be in band, I can like talk to, you know, everybody, and like I can hear what's going on, and I can have a story for, I used to run cross country, and one time one of my implants broke, like the actual sound processor, and so we were running, and I like told my friend, I'm like, please can you stay with me, because we were running right by the freeway, and it was really scary because I can only hear with one ear, and I'm like, I literally can't hear if a car comes up behind me, I can't hear like if they're honking. It was like super terrifying. So I can see like they're really important for those types of situations, and like knowing what's going on, because like what if like something explodes or whatever, and like you don't know. So So I feel like it's up to the people whether they want it or not. And we shouldn't try to force people to get it or not get it. That's my personal view.
So if a parent were to watch this and they're considering a cochlear implant for their child and they look at you and say, wow, you are an amazing person, you're a success, you're like doing amazing things in college, you're well-spoken, you hear everything, you understand, what if this, that kind of thing. Should they base their decision on how well everything has worked out for you?
I'm majoring in elementary education and communicative disorders. And I picked communicative disorders because I feel like I can put my own personal views and touch into people who, like parents and children, who can see that I'm successful, I made it through it, through everything. And my parents always said, like, I wish we had somebody like you to tell us, like, it'll be okay. Because they were like terrified, they didn't know what to do. And I was only three. And so, like, I want to help people say, like, hey, it'll be okay. Like, you'll be able to get through it, and it's not really, you know, that big of a deal. And, surgery is a little bit scary, but, like, the doctors do it all the time. So it's, like, it's okay. So, like, I feel like parents can, like, come to me and through communicative disorders and, like, that field that I'm going into, and, like, I can be, like, a reinsurance and, like, give them my own personal perspective and view and story, because, you know, I obviously wasn't held back by them.